For those of you that have been following the show over the past several weeks, you'll know that we've been talking about some somewhat serious subjects around ufology, that being the spiritual, religious side of ufology. And for tonight's show, the fact that it's the last show for the season, I thought we would take a little bit lighter subject. If you're friends of mine on Facebook, you may remember several weeks ago, I posted a couple of photos of a diorama, a model, if you will, that a gentleman had created on the Roswell wreck or crash. And I got a lot of feedback on that. People really liked it. So I hunted down the creator, the artist, and asked him to come and be a guest on the show, and he was nice enough to say yes. So we'll be talking to him tonight. Not only is he an artist and a modeler, but he's also, and I didn't know this, he is also a UFO cartoonist. So we'll be talking and showing a couple of his cartoons as well. His name is Matt Lowe, and he resides in Calgary, Alberta, Canada. And I believe this is our first guest, isn't it? Our first guest from Alberta. I know we've had people on from Vancouver. We've had people on from eastern portions of Canada, but nobody from Alberta yet. So this will be a first. Again, his name is Matt Lowe. You may know of him. You may not. I have not had a chance to talk to him yet, so this will be all new to me as well. So, don't go anywhere. We'll be right back after this quick message to speak to Mr. Matt Lowe. Don't go away.
These are American astronauts in training. Whatever emergencies confront them in outer space, they'll be ready. They're tough. They can take it. These men have to be in top physical shape when they face the countdown. And there's a new way to help keep you in shape for the space age. New post-count-off. Post-count-off is made with nutritious oats. You can count on it. Post-count-off is made in the shape of numbers. You can count on it. And look, you get this great space map free with just two count-off box tops. Packed with facts on space stations, spaceships, satellites, landings on the moon. It's free with just two post-count-off box tops. Start your day a little bit better with new post-count-off.
3, 2, 1.
You can count on it.
All right. Well, listen, it's time to bring on our guest for the evening. His name is Mr. Matt Lowe. He is a graphic designer, and I should have known this because from the work that I've seen, very professional stuff. This is not amateur. And he is coming from Alberta, Canada tonight. Mr. Matt, are you out there, sir?
Hello, Rick. Yes, I am.
How is Calgary, Alberta, Canada tonight?
It's really warm. I don't know what it is in Fahrenheit, but Celsius, it hit about 30, 32 degrees. So that's hot around here.
That is warm for that area. That's great. So, Matt, I came across a couple of photos of the model, or I guess you would call it almost a diorama, of this Roswell crash that you did. And I posted them on my Facebook page. And boy, did I get a lot of response. People just thought this thing was so cool. So then I said to myself, you know what? I have to see if I can get this guy on the show because I want to talk to him more about it. So thank you very much for taking the time to be here tonight.
No problem.
What I'm going to do, Matt, is I'm going to go ahead and bring up some photos and let the viewers look at what you built here, this model, this diorama. And they can view these pictures while we chat a bit.
Sure.
So I take it, besides being a graphic designer, you are also into ufology, or have been for some time now, huh?
Yeah, that's more of a recent thing. I mean, recent being maybe, you know, three, four years, I guess. Mm-hmm. I always kind of liked it as a kid, not very intently, but it was actually a coworker, a friend of mine, Mitch Wolf, who sort of got me into it when we were at work. He just sort of was talking about that kind of thing, and one thing led to another, and I just really got sparked into it and looked into things that he was referring me to. And it happened to be around the same time that a lot of media hype around aliens and UFOs, that kind of thing, ancient aliens and UFO hunters, those kind of things. And they were just available on TV and internet. And so I really got hooked into it and really found it compelling and interesting. So,
yeah, I mean, the media has really latched on to the whole UFO ET thing over the last few years, which is great, great. I know, my intro into this was a documentary about the Phoenix Lights that Dr. Lynn Kitai did. And all it takes is something like that to really, you know, boost your interest. So what made you do this diorama? I mean, because this is something you would see in a museum. I mean, this is museum quality stuff here, Matt.
Well, you know, I'm a hobby modeler. I'm not really, it doesn't occupy a lot of my free time. And I'm married with two little kids, so I don't have a lot of free time. But it all started because I just kind of wanted a desk toy or a little decoration of a UFO or craft of some sort. And so I started sort of tinkering around online, and I learned that the model company Testers, I think for their Roswell's 20th anniversary, made a pre-molded crash kit, complete with Red Rock, Roswell scenery, and a couple FBI agents, that kind of thing. But I think it was limited edition. I couldn't find it available anywhere. But they re-released a clean version, just the craft itself. And I just found it on eBay and bought it. And as a creative guy, my mind just starts spinning and spinning. And I just sort of painted this picture in my mind and thought, you know what, I don't want to make this. You know, the story's always been compelling, and I really wanted to place myself there, and I just wanted to make that scene. I wanted to make something I could look at and think about the story. So, I faked the crash damage myself and just sort of had an image of what I wanted to look like, and there was only really one set of military figures that were the same scale. And so I had to sort of use their postures, use their stances, and sort of figure out how to make a scene that sort of suited what I had in mind. And, there you go. That's what it came to.
I tell you, if you could mass produce these, you could probably, sell these things. I bet there'd be a lot of people that would buy them. I mean, it's that good.
Well, I did actually have someone ask me. They sent me an email, just the site it was posted on originally. Someone connected to me from there and asked me. And, it's really difficult. It was months and months of just here and there, an hour or two here and there when I felt like it or, had the time. And it's hard to put a price tag on it. I mean, it was my own personal piece of art that I kind of wanted. I wasn't ever thinking of selling it or really promoting it. I just kind of, the timing was right. As an artist, I'm never happy with my work. I could probably work every project to death, but I sort of needed to put a deadline on this, and it was about end of May. And that same friend, Mitch, I was sort of showing him progression photos, and and I could see it occupying a lot of my time. And I said, hey, you know what? I think the Roswell anniversary is coming up, beginning of July. I'm going to make that a deadline for myself and submit it sort of in time for that anniversary, the 67th, I believe. So that was sort of my deadline, and I sort of pushed through. I stayed up till 4 a.m. the night before just because I made that commitment to myself. I was like, I got to get this done. it's just eating me up. I'm thinking about it. I just need to get it done. So that's what I did.
So how long did it take you in total to complete this?
Oh, I can't even think. I mean, maybe 50, 60 hours sort of on and off here and there.
That's a lot. That is a lot of hours.
It is a lot of hours, especially with the figures. You can really get wrapped up in the detail, and you know, and because I'm a hobby modeler, I didn't really know all the tricks and techniques. And so I had to Google a lot of things, sort of, you know, how to make their clothing look like it's got deeper, those kind of things. So, yeah, this is really my first scenery model. I used to do sort of custom lowrider cars, that kind of thing when I was younger, just for fun. But this one really, really created itself in my mind within minutes of having the idea. So I really needed to just make it.
Well, if you ever do decide that you can part with it, maybe you should like donate it to the Roswell Museum or something, you know, with a little plaque with your name on it or something.
You know,
like
I totally would, you know, I just kind of wanted to, I've taken a zillion photos of it. So it's burned in my memory, and because it's getting such popularity, I'd love to send it away if someone was willing to post it somewhere. So.
Well, keep it for a while anyway. Keep it for a while and enjoy it.
If the price is right, I guess, you know.
Yeah, exactly. You can always put it on eBay with a high reserve and
yeah, exactly.
See what happens.
Yeah.
Well, you know, so why did you pick Roswell though? Is just because of, was that one of the first UFO stories that you became interested in when ufology became part of your life?
You know, the thing, you know, it was that my friend that really got me into it, but it was, if I could pinpoint the time that I really got, you know, it really piqued my interest, it was, I forget which episode, but it was the Ancient Aliens series, and I was just about to turn off the TV, and it was running on that program, and it was a certain episode about ancient architecture, you know, showing huge stone megaliths and, you know, million pound, you know, hewn stone. And it was just blowing my mind, you know, things I'd sort of heard about, but never really took into consideration how that was possible. And I mean, Roswell, everyone, you know, mostly everyone knows the story, whether just in passing or in detail.
Right.
It was actually the early or late 90s Unsolved Mysteries television program did a really interesting show on Roswell, and I was watching it, you know, about a year ago, and it just seemed extra cool. You know, I had heard other documentaries and other stories, but that one was really well done and had a few points of interest that aren't really repeated anywhere else. It was sort of at the same time I was looking for a little desk decoration of a UFO or a toy or something, and that's when I found the model, and I thought, hey, you know, I can make this how I want to make it. It doesn't just come out of a box. So it's a really compelling story, a lot of interesting evidence and stories, a lot of credible facts, and I just ate it up. And as I mentioned to you earlier, I just try to put myself in those gentlemen's shoes, you know, in the 1950s, you know, what the world was like, what technology was like, and, you know, really try to imagine being one of those guys coming out there.
Right.
And seeing this and experiencing this. And,
So tell me something, Matt. Do you personally believe that a craft did crash in Roswell in 1947?
You know, it's hard because, I mean, yes, an event absolutely took place there. And for whatever reason, the story got printed that it was a flying disc, whether that was someone being overzealous or what. But something obviously did happen. And, you know what? I want to believe it. I think it's awesome. We change as civilization. We change what we deem fact. Mm-hmm. About every 50 years. And, you know, we think this now, and then we think something else 50 years later. And, you know, just everything we're learning about the universe and, you know, the expanse and, you know, even what we can just see from Earth with our incredible telescopes, you know, I wouldn't put anything past.
I agree with you. I totally agree with you. You know, like you said, the original news release for Roswell was that, you know, they'd gotten this saucer, and I just can't understand how anybody could have confused a weather balloon, for a saucer. I just, it just doesn't make sense to me.
I agree.
Something just kind of weird there. And, with all the other information that's been gathered on this, I believe that something did happen.
Well, and one thing with a lot of stories is, and especially Roswell, because a lot of the people involved have passed away now after so many years, but you can see footage, you can read quotes from them, and I just find it hard to believe that direct witnesses and then witnesses in association with those witnesses would take the time and the effort to continue this made-up story at their own expense
Right.
if it wasn't true or had some truth to it. People don't just do that,
And on top of that, of course, the ridicule they put themselves in. I don't know why anybody would choose to do that. I don't know. It just seems to me like I guess all we can say is hopefully one day the truth will come out, but when
Yeah.
that will happen, I don't really
Well,
know.
a lot of other theorists or enthusiasts or scholars in this topic, and I agree with them, believe that we're getting closer. My kids, for example, I don't think they'd freak out. I think they'd be really interested, and there's just enough mainstream suggestion about it. I subscribe to National Geographic, and they definitely don't talk about UFOs and space aliens and stuff, but they keep the topic of, is there life out there? Are there other planets? And just mind-blowing stuff that just really puts into perspective what the universe is and what we are. And it's just, I believe anything at this point.
Yeah, I mean, the difference between now and say 30, 40 years ago, even, we have just come to learn so much more about the universe and what's out there that no one even knew existed. And it just boggles the mind. So I was just wondering, besides Roswell, do you have any other favorite UFO incidences that have captured you?
I sort of subscribe to a lot of people's theories that contend 95% of most UFO sightings or stories are explainable or dismissible, but 5% just are too strange and too heavily witnessed and too impossible to explain away. And there's a couple. The one of my favorites is, I think it's Japan Airlines
Yes.
1628 with really senior ranking pilot, and not only a senior ranking pilot, but a Japanese senior ranking pilot, in the 80s, and he was an elderly man in the 80s, so he would have grown up with a different culture where your family name and your respect and honor, that kind of thing, and that would have been ingrained in him. So for him to just make up and put his life, his it, he put his career in serious jeopardy and suffer ridicule the rest of his life, but to just make up a crazy story of seeing this ginormous, absolutely enormous sphere following them for quite, I can't remember how long, but many, many minutes and many miles
Yep.
on their way to Alaska.
Just amazing stuff.
I'm sort of conservative guy, so I tend to sort of give both sides the benefit of the doubt or give them enough credibility, but one way or another, something weird is going on in the skies, and whether it's mind-blowing military technology or beings from outer space, if it was military technology, why? What is the purpose of making these, incredible technological advancements and flying them around and teasing aircraft? And it just there's just a lot of weirdness surrounding it that makes me interested and kind of believe and be excited to believe in that kind of thing.
And what do you find when you're talking about this stuff with friends or family? Do people look at you and give you that strange look, or are you surrounded by people that are at least open-minded enough to hear you out?
Well, funny enough, like my dad, for example, I don't go into too much depth, but he knows I'm sort of interested and, like to watch documentaries on it and that kind of thing. And he's a pretty conservative guy, but, just with our advancements in technology and our advancements in, knowledge of our galaxies and solar system, he doesn't say yes or no, but he doesn't think I'm crazy. And, especially the help of the media, I mean, a lot of people are sort of giving it a lot more credibility. And I know I've seen polls and, voting experiments asking people. And, there's a good, healthy portion of the population that feel okay and figure it's probably true and there's probably something happening. And not in a terrified way either. Just sort of, yeah, I'm sure it's happening.
Yeah, exactly. It amazes me the amount and the cross-section of people that have become interested in ufology and are openly discussing it. Like you said, I think a lot of it has to do with the media. I mean, my God, it seems like every week there's a new show on television regarding UFOs, right?
It's
Which
true.
is a good thing, really, I think, for most of them anyway.
Well, and I also think, if you just mention the topic or, mention your interest or belief in it, the ordinary person may think, oh, it's sci-fi stuff, you're kind of kooky. But, I was sort of in that position at one point, but, watched the documentaries, read some literature, read testimonials, watched people talking about it. And if you take the time to really sort of look into it, it's not as crazy as you might think. It's really interesting. And I mean, true or not, it's really fun and really compelling stuff. I love it.
Yeah, absolutely. And that's what I've always said. If you talk to somebody who says, it's a bunch of hogwash, I can almost guarantee you those people have done little to no investigation.
Sure.
Because I just don't think anybody with, normal intelligence can look at the evidence and come back with an answer that nope, this is not real, this is not happening. It's just not possible. There's just
Well,
too much evidence.
exactly. And to revisit your question of are there a couple stories that really stand out along with Roswell? Yeah, you mentioned the Arizona lights. I mean, thousands of witnesses, and I've even seen some interview with a family that say they saw the craft, come slowly right over their house. And, you see this family, I mean, the father, the daughter, the mother, telling the same story, standing together. And you just see their body language, you see the way they're talking, you see their enthusiasm, and they're not just trying to get some press, And I mean, even the mayor of Phoenix went on the
Governor,
record.
governor.
Yeah, or governor, sorry. Yeah, after his, when he was done and said, actually, yeah, I did. It wasn't good press for me to admit it during my position, but now that I'm not that anymore, then yeah, I did. And why? I mean, what does he benefit from saying, hey, I'm a crazy person, I saw something in the sky? I mean, he doesn't. He doesn't at all.
And you would think that something like that, a governor
Yeah.
coming out and saying that, you would think that would be just front page news and the press would be all over it and then we'd have investigations, etc.,
Sure.
etc. But it was just swept under the rug.
Well,
That's what kills me.
and even so, I mean, even if you brush away extraterrestrial involvement, let's pretend it's a 3 mile wide military produced aircraft. Let's just pretend. Why on earth is it hovering around Arizona being obvious? And why on earth does the military have and need a 3 mile wide ginormous, silent, floating craft. Yep. You know, one way or another, something is weird. And that's what I find so compelling about this whole topic.
Yeah, I mean, you know, regardless of the interdimensional, the outer space theories, we have things flying around in our secure airspace. That yeah. should be enough right there to warrant investigation.
Yeah. Oh,
as
yeah.
As far as I'm concerned. Well, listen, Matt, we're just about out of time here, but I wanted to share a couple of other things with the viewers of yours, and that is a couple of your cartoons, I guess they would be, or comics.
Yeah.
This first one here with the the gentleman.
Giorgio Tsoukalos?
Yeah.
It's Giorgio Tsoukalos from Ancient Aliens.
Yes. Oh, we'll pull this up. Let the folks see this. But this is great. You know, wow, he's got it completely wrong, or what?
Gosh, well, you know, yeah, I just, yeah, you know, I love the show, and you know, and I was just I was at work one day, and I was just sort of thinking about an episode or something, and I thought, you know, everyone's got their theories and they're cool. You know, he's got cool theories and I dig it. But I thought, you know, what if there was ETs? What if he's totally way off? And then, you know, the same way that my Roswell diorama just sort of painted itself in my head, that, you know, the same perspective, the same position, that whole comic just painted itself in my head. And I ripped it out right there on the spot. I was like, oh man, I got to draw this. And so I just did. And then my friend Mitch said, hey, you know what? You should send that to Coast to Coast. And I did.
And they liked it.
Yeah, they did. Yeah, he put it up, and it was fun. I got some feedback. People liked it, and it was sort of right at the hype of Ancient Aliens, so it was really relevant, you know, seeing Tsoukalos on there. So.
And then this other one here with the George Norrie hybrid.
Yeah.
I'm not so sure about this one. Where did you say you got the DNA again? There's George. Yeah. With the half alien bottle or half alien body and the bottle.
Yeah, no, that was just a friendly roast for those guys at Coast to Coast. So I just and you know what, then they put it up, and I appreciate it. You know, I don't have a Facebook page. I'm not a Twitter guy. I keep to myself a bit. So, you know, I wasn't expecting much, but it was sort of fun to post the first one. And so I thought, hey, you know what? I'll just kind of give them something fun the second time around. So.
Well, I think you should maybe start a website and, you know, maybe even a UFO comic strip of some kind would be.
Well, you know, it's been in the works in my mind. You know, I've got too many ideas in there, and they're just all in due time. So this may be a start, though. So I appreciate it. Thank you.
That's great. That's great. Well, listen, Matt, it was great having you on. I know it was kind of a last minute thing, and I'm so happy that you took the time to come visit with us today.
No problem. Thank you, Rick.
The model of Roswell is just fantastic, and the comics are great as well. So keep up the good work, and you know, if you do come up with some more of these things, please don't hesitate to share them with us, because we would love to see them.
No problem. Thank you again.
Okay. You have a great evening, and we'll stay in touch.
Thanks a lot, Rick. Okay. Good night.
Good night. Good night, everyone.
Is to keep it. You'll believe it when you find something screaming across your mind. Green slime.
And I mean, true or not, it's really fun and really compelling stuff. I love it.
Yeah, absolutely. You know, and that's what I've always said. You know, if you talk to somebody who says, it's a bunch of hogwash, you know, I can almost guarantee you those people have done little to no investigation.
Sure.
Because I just don't think anybody with, you know, normal intelligence can look at the evidence and come back with an answer that, no, this is not real, this is not happening. It's just not possible. There's just too much evidence.
Well, exactly. And to revisit your question of are there a couple stories that really stand out along with Roswell? You mentioned the Arizona lights. I mean, thousands of witnesses, you know, and I've even seen some interview with a family that say they saw the craft, you know, come slowly right over their house. And, you know, you see this family, I mean, the father, the daughter, the mother, telling the same story, standing together. And you just see their body language, you see the way they're talking, you see their enthusiasm, and they're not just trying to get some press, you know. And I mean, even the mayor of Phoenix went
governor,
on the record.
Governor.
Yeah, or governor, sorry. Yeah, after his, you know, when he was done, and said, actually, yeah, I did. You know, it wasn't good press for me to admit it during my position, but now that I'm not that anymore, then yeah, I did. And you know why? I mean, what does he benefit from saying, hey, I'm a crazy person, I saw something in the sky? I mean, he doesn't at all.
And you would think that something like that, you know, a governor coming out and saying that, you would think that would be just front page news and the press would be all over it and then we'd have investigations, et cetera, et cetera.
Sure.
But it was just swept under the rug. Kills me.
Well, and even so, I mean, even if you brush away extraterrestrial involvement, let's pretend it's a, you know, 3 mile wide military produced aircraft. let's just pretend. Why on earth is it hovering around Arizona being obvious? And why on earth does the military have and need a 3 mile wide ginormous silent floating craft? You know, one way or another, something is weird, and that's what I find so compelling about this whole topic.
Yeah, I mean, regardless of the interdimensional, the outer space theories, we have things flying around in our secure airspace that should be enough right there to warrant investigation.
As
far as I'm concerned. Well, listen,
You know, the thing, you know, it was that my friend that really got me into it, but it was, if I could pinpoint the time that I really got, you know, it really piqued my interest, it was, I forget which episode, but it was the Ancient Aliens series, and I was just about to turn off the TV, and it was running on that program, and it was a certain episode about ancient architecture, you know, showing huge stone megaliths and, you know, million-pound, you know, hewn stone, and it was just blowing my mind, you know, things I'd sort of heard about but never really took into consideration how that was possible. And I mean, Roswell, everyone, you know, mostly everyone knows the story, whether just in passing or in detail,
right?
But it was actually the early or late 90s Unsolved Mysteries television program did a really interesting show on Roswell, and I was watching it, you know, about a year ago, and it just seemed extra cool. You know, I had heard other documentaries and other stories, but that one was really well done and had a few points of interest that aren't really repeated anywhere else. It was sort of at the same time I was looking for a little desk decoration of a UFO or a toy or something, and that's when I found the model, and I thought, hey, you know, I can make this how I want to make it. It doesn't just come out of a box, so... it's a really compelling story. A lot of interesting evidence and stories, a lot of credible facts, and I just ate it up. And as I mentioned to you earlier, I just try to put myself in those gentlemen's shoes, you know, in the 1950s, you know, what the world was like, what technology was like, and, you know, really try to imagine being one of those guys coming out there.
Right.
And seeing this and experiencing this, and
so tell me something, Matt. Do you personally believe that a craft did crash in Roswell in 1947?
You know, it's hard because, I mean, yes, an event absolutely took place there. And for whatever reason, the story got printed that it was a flying disc, whether that was someone being overzealous or what. But something obviously did happen. And, yeah, you know what? I want to believe it. I think it's awesome. We change as civilization. We change what we deem fact. Mm-hmm. About every 50 years. And, you know, we think this now, and then we think something else 50 years later. And, just everything we're learning about the universe and, you know, the expanse and, you know, even what we can just
see. Openly discussing it. Like you said, I think a lot of it has to do with the media. I mean, my God, it seems like every week there's a new show on television regarding UFOs, right?
That's true.
Which is a good thing, really, I think, for most of them anyway.
Well, and I also think, if you just mention the topic or, you know, mention your interest or belief in it, the ordinary person may think, oh, you know, it's sci-fi stuff, you're kind of kooky. But, I was sort of in that position at one point, but, you know, watched the documentaries, read some literature, read testimonials, watched people talking about it. And if you take the time to really sort of look into it, it's not as crazy as you might think. It's really interesting. And I mean, true or not, it's really fun and really compelling stuff. I love it.
Yeah, absolutely. And that's what I've always said. You know, if you talk to somebody who says, it's a bunch of hogwash, I can almost guarantee you those people have done little to no investigation.
Sure.
Because I just don't think anybody with, normal intelligence can look at the evidence and come back with an answer that, nope, this is not real, this is not happening. It's just not possible. There's just too much evidence.
Well, exactly. And to revisit your question of are there a couple stories that really stand out along with Roswell? You mentioned the Arizona lights. I mean, thousands of witnesses, and I've even seen some interview with a family that say they saw the craft, come slowly right over their house. And, you see this family, I mean, the father, the daughter, the mother, telling the same story, standing together. And you just see their body language, you see the way they're talking, you see their enthusiasm, and they're not just trying to get some press, And I mean, even the mayor of Phoenix went
governor.
On the record.
Governor.
Yeah, or governor, sorry. Yeah, after his, when he was done, and said, actually, yeah, I did. It wasn't good press for me to admit it during my position, but now that I'm not that anymore, then yeah, I did. And why? I mean, what does he benefit from saying, hey, I'm a crazy person, I saw something in the sky? I mean, he doesn't at all.
And you would think that something like that, a governor coming out and saying that, you would think that would be just front page news and the press would be all over it and then we'd have investigations, et cetera, et cetera.
Sure.
But it was just swept under the rug.
That
kills me.
Well, and even so, I mean, even if you, brush away.
Get this guy on the show because I want to talk to him more about it. So thank you very much for taking the time to be here tonight.
No problem.
What I'm going to do, Matt, is I'm going to go ahead and bring up some photos and let the viewers look at what you built here, this model, this diorama, and they can view these pictures while we chat a bit.
Sure.
So, I take it, besides being a graphic designer, you are also into ufology, or have been for some time now, huh?
Yeah, it's more of a recent thing. I mean, recent being maybe, three, four years, I guess. Mm-hmm. I always kind of liked it as a kid, not very intently, but it was actually a coworker, a friend of mine, Mitch Wolf, who sort of got me into it when we were at work. He just sort of talking about that kind of thing, and one thing led to another, and I just really got sparked into it and looked into things that he was referring me to. And it happened to be around the same time that a lot of media hype around aliens and UFOs, that kind of thing, ancient aliens and UFO hunters, those kind of things. And they were just available on TV and internet. And so I really got hooked into it and really found it compelling and interesting. So,
yeah, I mean, the media has really latched on to the whole UFO ET thing over the last few years, which is great, which is great. I know, my intro into this was a documentary about the Phoenix Lights that Dr. Lynn Kitai did. And all it takes is something like that to really, you know, boost your interest. So what made you do this diorama? I mean, because this is something you would see in a museum. I mean, this is museum quality stuff here, Matt.
Well, you know, I'm a hobby modeler. I'm not really, it doesn't occupy a lot of my free time. And I'm married with two little kids, so I don't have a lot of free time. But it all started because I just kind of wanted a desk toy or a little decoration of a UFO or craft of some sort. And so I started sort of tinkering around online, and I learned that the model company Testers, I think for their Roswell's 20th anniversary, made a pre-molded crash kit, complete with Red Rock, Roswell scenery, and a couple FBI agents, that kind of thing. But I think it was limited edition. I couldn't find it available anywhere. But they re-released a clean version, just the craft itself. And I just found it on eBay and bought it. And as a creative guy, my mind just, selling it or really promoting it, I just kind of, the timing was right. As an artist, I'm never happy with my work. I could probably work every project to death, but I sort of needed to put a deadline on this, and it was about end of May. And that same friend, Mitch, I was sort of showing him progression photos, and and I could see it occupying a lot of my time. And I said, hey, you know what? I think the Roswell anniversary is coming up, the beginning of July. I'm going to make that a deadline for myself and submit it sort of in time for that anniversary, the 67th, I believe. So that was sort of my deadline, and I sort of pushed through. I stayed up till 4 a.m. the night before just because I made that commitment to myself. I was like, I got to get this done. I just got to, it's just eating me up. I'm thinking about it. I just need to get it done. So that's what I did.
So how long did it take you in total to complete this?
Oh, I can't even think. I mean, maybe 50, 60 hours sort of on and off here and there.
That's a lot. That is a lot of hours.
It is a lot of hours, especially with the figures. You can really get wrapped up in the detail and because I'm a hobby modeler, I didn't really know all the tricks and techniques. And so I had to Google a lot of things, sort of, how to make their clothing look like it's got deeper, those kind of things. So this is really my first scenery model. I used to do sort of custom lowrider cars, that kind of thing, when I was younger, just for fun. But this one really, really created itself in my mind within minutes of having the idea. So I really needed to just make it.
Well, if you ever do decide that you can part with it, maybe you should donate it to the Roswell Museum or something, with a little plaque with your name on it or something.
I totally would. I just kind of wanted to. I've taken a zillion photos of it, so it's burned in my memory. And because it's getting such popularity, I'd love to send it away if someone was willing to post it somewhere.
So. Well, keep it for a while anyway. Keep it for a while and enjoy it.
If the price is right, I guess.
Yeah. Exactly. You can always put it on eBay with a high reserve and
yeah,
see what happens.
Yeah.
Well, so why did you pick Roswell though? Is just because of, was that one of the first UFO stories that you became interested in when ufology became part of your life?
The thing, it was that my friend that really got me into it, but it was, if I could pinpoint the time that I really got, it really piqued my interest. It was, I forget which episode, but it was the Ancient Aliens series, and I was just about to turn off the TV, and it was running on that program, and it was a certain episode about...
Do you personally believe that a craft did crash in Roswell in 1947?
You know, it's hard because, I mean, yes, an event absolutely took place there. And for whatever reason, the story got printed that it was a flying disc, whether that was someone being overzealous or what. But something obviously did happen. And, yeah, you know what? I want to believe it. I think it's awesome. We change as civilization. We change what we deem fact. Mm-hmm. About every 50 years. And, you know, we think this now, and then we think something else 50 years later. And, just everything we're learning about the universe and, you know, the expanse and, you know, even what we can just see from Earth with our incredible telescopes, you know, I wouldn't put anything past.
I agree with you. I totally agree with you. Like you said, the original news release for Roswell was that, you know, they'd gotten this saucer, and I just can't understand how anybody could have confused a weather balloon, for a saucer. It just doesn't make sense to me.
I agree.
Something just kind of weird there. And, with all the other information that's been gathered on this, I believe that something did happen.
Well, and one thing with a lot of stories is, and especially Roswell, because, a lot of the people involved have passed away now after so many years. But, you can see footage, you can read, quotes from them. And I just find it hard to believe that direct witnesses and then witnesses in association with those witnesses would take the time and the effort to continue this made-up story at their own expense,
right,
if it wasn't true or had some truth to it. You know, people don't just do that, you know?
And on top of that, of course, you know, the ridicule they put themselves I don't know why anybody would choose to do that. I don't know. It just seems to me I guess all we can say is hopefully one day the truth will come out. But when that will happen, I don't really know.
And a lot of other theorists or, you know, enthusiasts or scholars in this topic, and I agree with them, believe that, you know, showing huge stone megaliths and, you know, million pound, you know, hewn stone. And it was just blowing my mind, you know, things I'd sort of heard about, but never really took into consideration how that was possible. And Roswell, everyone, you know, mostly everyone knows the story, whether just in passing or in detail.
Right.
It was actually the early or late 90s Unsolved Mysteries television program did a really interesting show on Roswell. And I was watching it, you know, about a year ago, and it just seemed extra cool. You know, I had heard other documentaries and other stories, but that one was really well done and had a few points of interest that aren't really repeated anywhere else. It was sort of at the same time I was looking for a little desk decoration of a UFO or a toy or something, and that's when I found the model, and I thought, hey, you know, I can make this how I want to make it. It doesn't just come out of a box. So it's a really compelling story, a lot of interesting evidence and stories, a lot of credible facts, and I just ate it up. And as I mentioned to you earlier, I just try to put myself in those gentlemen's shoes, you know, in the 1950s, you know, what the world was like, what technology was like, and, really try to imagine being one of those guys coming out there.
Right.
And seeing this and experiencing this. And,
So tell me something, Matt. Do you personally believe that a craft did crash in Roswell in 1947?
You know, it's hard because, I mean, yes, an event absolutely took place there. And for whatever reason, the story got printed that it was a flying disc, whether that was someone being overzealous or what, but something obviously did happen. And you know what? I want to believe it. I think it's awesome. We change as civilization. We change what we deem fact mm-hmm. about every 50 years. And, we think this now, and then we think something else 50 years later. And, just everything we're learning about the universe and, the expanse and, even what we can just see from Earth with our incredible telescopes, I wouldn't put anything past.
I agree with you. I totally agree with you. Like you said, the original news release for Roswell was that, they'd gotten this saucer. And I just can't understand how anybody